blessed and highly favored.
Praise God. I randomly chose commitment, and I believe that's the word that God wanted me to speak on. So the first thing I did was look up the dictionary. And I got for commitment, solemn promise, and undertaking. And secondly, a promise to give yourself, your money, your time, etc., to support or buy something. And then I thought I would include my definition. My definition of commitment is to be steady and not waver, not to be wishy-washy, not to be a person who first works at something and later decides not to follow through as it should be done. And also a person who is loyal, devoted, focused, and reliable, willing to make sacrifices, do what is necessary for the benefit of others. The example of commitment from the Bible that came to me was that of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus' example is the ultimate example of all time. Our Lord was committed to the very end, right up to his death. His death that he was well aware of, that he knew of. He was altogether wrongful because he was innocent. Jesus was committed to the end of his young life, bring to this creation of humanity salvation, a personal relationship with him, to be able to live a righteous and godly life and receive eternal life in his kingdom forever in his company.
Yes.
And I found five verses. They're short. They're all in Matthew 27, and the first one is 23. They all replied, "Let him be crucified." And Pilate said, "Why? What has he done that is evil?" But they shouted all the louder, "Let him be crucified." And then Matthew 27:26, so Pilate set free for them Barabbas, and had Jesus whipped, and delivered Jesus up to be crucified. And Matthew 27:46, and about the ninth hour, 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice in his language, that is, "My God, my God, why have you abandoned me, leaving me helpless, forsaking, and failing me in your need?" And Matthew 27:50, and Jesus cried again with a loud voice and gave up his spirit. And so now I will give you, in a nutshell, my testimony. As for me, it's been my personal experience that as long as I stay committed, and follow the lead of the Holy Spirit, God will always be there for me, through the good and the bad. I've been to both hell and back, and thankfully I come back better. From my severe anxiety breakdowns, which are sad and filled with fear, husbands who are mean, abusive, or cowardly and rebelling against God, and people who are selfish, unfair, and also my own mistakes, and also my own sin. And lastly, I would like to share with you an affirmation that I received back in March of 2004. I love it so much that I couldn't part with it, so I kept it, and it's become yellowed. And my daughter, she laminated it for me. And I had to read this more often, but I never threw it away. Of course, I had to keep it. I didn't want to part with it. And I never thought of this testimony as being committed. But it's, I labeled it committed. And as you will hear, that's what it's about. It's about being committed. In a recent sermon by Robert Kopp, I came across this affirmation, which was posted on the wall of his house by a young African pastor. May it be our testimony as well. I'm part of the Fellowship of the Unashamed, I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I'm a disciple of His. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I'm finished and done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed visions, mundane talking, cheap living, and warped goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I don't have to be right, first, tops, recognized, praised, departed, or rewarded. I now live by faith, lean on His presence.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Come on, sister. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Lord, hallelujah.
I now live by faith, lean on His presence, walk by patience, live by prayer, and labor by power. My face is set, my gate is past, my goal is heaven, my road is narrow. My way rough, my companions few, my guide reliable, my mission clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of the adversary, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I won't give up, shut up, let up, until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, preached up for the cause of Christ.
Come on.
I am a disciple of Jesus. I must wait till He comes, give till I drop, preach till all know, and work till He stops me. And when He comes for His own, He will have no problems recognizing me.
Amen.
My banner will be clear.
Amen.
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 Each of us are faced with numerous choices. For
free will or the freedom to make our own choices is a very important issue in our society. Every day, each of us chooses to do the things that we do. Our choices can result in consequences of great magnitude, while others don't. Messages in our society stresses our right to choose, but they aren't balanced with the choices and the consequences of our choices. We face temptation that we must resist through the word of God, through the truth of God. The consequences of some choices are more deadly than others. Wrong choices can cause our souls to become sick. God wants to heal us, to restore us, and to renew us. So what are some of the principles to make wise choices? What does the Bible say that could help me make decisions that are right? In Proverbs 3:5, it says, trust the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. So God is there helping us along the way if we're with the truth. Isn't it a blessing to know that you don't have to do this yourself?
Amen.
So when you're making a choice, ask yourself, what does the Bible have to say about this decision? Who can help me better understand what God's word has to say? Well, sometimes coming to church to hear the word is important. Talking with brothers or sisters in the church, asking our pastor, first lady, reading the Bible yourself.
Amen.
Make sure you are not the only one that's believing what you're reading. So, right? If there's other people that are agreeing with it, the choice is better. In Philippians 4:8, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute. If there's any excellent, if it's anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. Of our character, what is honorable? Are these the right choices for me? Another way to look is anything you do before making a decision or chewing, do I have all the facts? Proverbs says in 18:13, says he who answers, he who gives an answer before he hears it, is folly and shame to him. So ask yourself a lot of questions. Remember, every story has two sides. Another question to ask about your choice, what's my motive? Proverbs 29 says, I've cleansed my heart, I am pure from sin. So ask yourself to honestly assess your motives, both good and bad. What will I gain from my choices? Could my choice jeopardize my integrity or hinder my witness for the Lord? Proverbs 22:1 says, a good name is to be more desired than great riches. Favor is better than silver and gold. So there are many choices in our lives. There are some that are insignificant, but set in motion a series of events that shape our life, the life of your children and your grandchildren. For instance, if you think about how did you come to know Jesus, you may have just started out with someone telling you about it, and from that, the outcome is life-changing. So sometimes people make unwise choices with meaningful and life-changing results. Choices can result in eternally significant consequences. Choose in line with God's principles. So our future is determined by all the choices we're making today. Let's bring God into helping us make our decision. In doing so, we'll determine our future, we'll be secure, and we'll have God's blessings in it. Amen. Let's be like Joshua, who was and declares, for me and my house we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
God promised Joshua good success if he obeyed his words, and he chose to follow him. Joshua and his family were blessed because he made the right choices. Even though he went through many battles, God was with him. He was an overcomer. in group, I gave a presentation, I had the clients submitted a paper, and the question I asked, what do you fear the most? And this young man's answer really was profound. I asked him if I could share it because it was so intense, he said I could. The question was, what do you fear the most? He wrote, he fears that he will never really be normal again or looked at as a good-hearted person with only good intentions. I fear if I have kids, they will endure the same situations that I have undergone or worse situations. I fear I'm going to be hated or ridiculed for my past, and most of all, never accomplish any of my goals because of it. I fear lying on my deathbed and being remembered only as a five-time convicted felon. So the choices you make today, how are they going to impact your life? How will the choices affect your family, your children, your grandchildren?
Your mind, your body, your soul, or even your spirit.
Yeah.
Right. Jeremiah 4:18 says, your ways and your doings have procured these things for you. This is your wickedness, because it is bitter, because it reaches to your heart. When you let sin into your heart, you're setting yourself up for bitterness. You become bitter towards God and unto others. God hates sin. Sin is not only dangerous, it is bitter, it is the source of all bitterness. Sin is not a wound in the flesh, but I believe it's a disease in the heart. That's where it was born, that's where it started, and where it circulates. When sin reaches to you in the heart, it distracts it. It has no peace, no spiritual calmness, no happiness. When you let sin into your heart, it pollutes it. It isolates it from God. It has no sympathy with God, no desire to please Him.
My God.
Amen.
Now, I just want to give you a few words that are some sins that can cause bitterness, and a few words that are emotional injuries that can cause bitterness. One of them is unforgiveness. Forgive and forget. Don't hold a grudge on someone who caused your pain. Another is unrighteous anger. Unrighteous anger can shut things down as far as communication and breaks relationships apart. This emotion can turn into resentment, which poisons our thinking and our behavior. You can burst into an expression of rage that will hurt not only you, not only the one you made angry, but others. Another one is jealousy.
Oh yeah.
When some someone gets things you don't have, but you want, you start to become jealous.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Or you see another woman and she looks really, really pretty, and you're jealous for of that young lady for no apparent reason, because she looks beautiful. You start to hate her for no reason. You don't even know why you hate her, just because she's gorgeous.
Yeah.
Same for the men. You see a good-looking guy, you start to get a little jealous, like, who does he think he is? He got a nice car, he's got a better suit than you.
Come on.
You start to become jealous, you start to hate the brother.
Yes.
The Bible says love one another.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen. When you don't get your way, you seek attention,
Jesus.
You whine, you start drama to get attention.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because you didn't receive this attention, you become bitter.
Jesus.
Rejection. Rejection can lead to sin that can cause bitterness. There is rejection when you were a child, rejected by your parents. I mean, it could be anything. It could be your spouse, your husband, your wife. You feel rejected, you feel lonely, you feel hurt. Betrayal, another one, pain. When you're betrayed by someone you love so dearly, and you don't expect that person to betray you, but that person has betrayed you. And it kills you so much inside, it kills your heart, but you let sin into your heart, which can cause bitterness to your husband or your wife. Trusting in him. You fall away from the Lord. Now you're into the world because the things that you go through, because this pain is in your heart. So right now, God is not first in your life. Again, these are just a few words that I gave you that can cause bitterness. Some are emotional injuries that can cause bitterness. Now there's one word that I mentioned that I believe is a dangerous sin. And that is unforgiveness.
Yes.
Yes. Unforgiveness is a serious sin. Like I said, it's a dangerous one. Because if you cannot forgive others, then what makes you think God can forgive you? You can find that in Matthew 6:15.
Yeah.
A continuous, unforgiving, bitter, and angry spirit will kill a person's heart, making them shipwreck their faith and prove they never belong to God. That's how serious this sin is.
Serious.
The Bible says, if you hate your brother, you have killed him.
Oh!
And you can find that in Matthew 5:21-22.
That's right.
Bitterness is unforgiveness fermented. The more we hold on to past hurts, the more we become drunk on our own pain. And the experience can rob us of the joy we can find in anything. Because of this pain that we have, we start to take on the things of the world instead of seeking the kingdom of God. We let sin enter into our hearts and become bitter. And when we become bitter, we become unclean or impure.
Yep.
Hebrews 12:15 says, looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. Again, unclean or impure. So we must check ourselves, saints.
My God.
Stay close to God.
Yes, that's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Don't let any root of bitterness enter into your heart and cause trouble. Get rid of all sin. Sin is the source of all bitterness. And I know it's hard when you've been hurt or your heart is in pain. You feel like giving up. You feel like there's no hope. You feel like giving up. But just don't.
Right.
Don't give up. And I'm a perfect example because I've been hurt so bad years ago. My husband always, he said it was okay to speak about me being hurt. I became bitter towards my husband because of past issues, because I was so hurt and damaged. My heart was shattered. I became so bitter, I didn't want to come to church. I'm sinning. Those are sins that I became bitter. That's so dangerous to become bitter. Have bitterness is so dangerous. Bitterness can kill you mentally, emotionally, physically. I became so bitter towards my husband, I almost lost my husband. And when it came down to it, he got tired of me not wanting to go to church, not listening. And he understood why I became bitter. Don't get me wrong, he understood it, and he held on and just tried and tried and tried and tried. And we had our time speaking to the pastor about it, and I was just wrong. Instead of seeking the kingdom of God, I let this pain take over me, and I became bitter. Yes. Instead of reading the word like my husband was trying to get me to do, instead of forgiving him, because I didn't really forgive, I forgave him, but I didn't forgive him. You know what I mean? I didn't fully forgive him. So I became bitter, and I let things went so bad that I almost lost my husband. And I just thank God, because that's what the enemy wanted.
Come on.
Yeah. Amen.
But he didn't win.
Glory be to God.
Use plethora. So we need to have a plethora of faith.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.